oil prices are going down and Kazakh oil is the cost, it is very costly, yes, to produce Kazakh oil, because not only transportation, but because of some oil fields are old enough, oil quality, the viscosity is high enough, there is a sulfur component over there. Now, in terms of this other kind of statistics, share in export, in exports for our overall, it's also it's around like 60%, which is huge number. And I mean, that's why for Kazakhstan, this question of currency kind of stability, also devaluation issues with the low oil prices, it's very painful. Yes, sharing government revenues, it's also kind of taxes which are collected from the oil business. And right now, by the way, this taxation schemes for oil sector is becoming more and more flexible. So government is making steps to keep it alive, first of all, through the devaluation things, and second, through this connection of the taxation scale with the oil prices. Yes? So except of all these economic considerations, there is a huge social expectations, understanding of the oil sector. Yes? People, they look to the news and they look what's going on with the oil prices. Yes, and there are a lot of debates. What is going on, why we are so kind of connected with oil, why we are kind of doomed to be oil state, petro state. So you see the social understanding was that oil is something which is very important, hope for development, but it should have been something more, yes? Done in times of all these high oil prices in terms of to cut the dependence on this oil things. Yes? So cruel choices in time of kind of necessity. What is going on if currency, hard currency is not coming? And if state revenues are falling, government last two years, they conducted several series of devaluations, and this budget, sequestering the budget, yes? So you see all the things, some kind of people, there is certain pressure in the society, and we will talk about it. So the debate is how to revive the economy, to spend money or to cut this budget spending. Why the spending is, the debate is going on because in times of like when oil prices were falling and Russian ruble was falling, Kazakh government was keeping stability of the tenge, yes? And a lot of hard currency reserves were spent to keep the stability of tenge. And still it didn't work well, economy was slowing down. And now different strategy came forward to cut the budget spending. Yes, several times president, prime minister, they publicly declared that the budget spending will be cut. Yes, and first of all, it was said about this efficiency of the spending. Yes, about this national companies that their budgets have to be reconsidered, that the salaries of the officials in the parastatal agencies should be reconsidered, all the things. So Kazakhstan is trying to adapt to the low oil price time, yes? So monetary, as I said, this macroeconomic, public investment, social security issues, all of them, they are discussed in terms of what is going on with this revenue from oil, yes? For last 15 years, except of the crisis in 2008, oil prices were growing. Yes, and Kazakh states, they were more or less used to solve a lot of issues with the oil money. Yes? So this devaluation shock, it was a lot of debates in Kazakhstan about devaluation, because first devaluation happened like in February, and second maybe is going on right now. Yes, I think yesterday it was, today it was some kind of another shock of this devaluation things, yes. And why there are debates? As I said, money from national funds, which were saved over there in terms of high oil prices, they were spent to keep the currency rate stable, yes. And it didn't work out. Now a lot of pressures from exporters were that we are losing competition, our costs are so high. So government followed their lobbying efforts, and the currency rate was I mean, the support was canceled, yes? So, political social issues, I put over here this topic of repressiveness versus liberalization. Why? Because it was some discussion that in times of high oil prices, Kazakh state, they kind of stopped social reforms, yes, and all these liberal efforts of the 90s, like first half of the 2000s, yes, it was forgotten, and right now when oil prices will go down, automatically it means that now state will be much more liberal. It didn't happen so far, and our kind of policies over there, I would say the last year, a lot of things, I mean, there is no any sign that it will go to the liberal path. And I will explain it further in the second slide, I think. Yes. So, what's going on? These political issues, as we see, yes, in case of oil-rich state and the history of oil-rich state, there is this concept of so-called boom-bust cycle. Yes, boom cycle when the oil prices are going down and loyalty of the citizens is bought. Every all elite groups, they are more or less in consensus and everyone has its share of its rent, yes? When the bust cycle is coming, there are a lot of issues are coming forward, yes? First of all, certain elite groups, they are lacking their part of the rent, yes, and they are unhappy about it. And citizens, society also, they exert certain pressure for more open type of the things, yes? So you see, Kazakhstan in this regard is a classic case, yes, and we don't have any kind of ambitions of the great powers when they can solve some of the problems of economic issues inside through the external type of the small victories, ambitions, and so on, yes? So you see, reserves and resources for economic stability in this regard, what's going on, what will happen with the political will of the our government, yes, how far they are willing to sacrifice the dominant position of the state. And certain efforts, they were already in place. First of all, business promotion in terms of registration of business is much kind of faster right now. Also, there are debates about this tax reform, which to revive the business activities in non-oil sector. Yes, and one of the things also that in case of Kazakhstan, we have huge share of government in economy, yes? And then there were a lot of warnings that it will not be really well, and right now there is a program for privatization. So you see this business promotion, privatization efforts, they're again on agenda, like it was in the 90s when oil prices were low. I put over here this topic of the repressiveness towards labor, because recently Kazakhstan adopted new labor code, and now, and it is made, it is designed, first of all, for the interest of employer, yes? And trade unions in Kazakhstan, traditionally, they are not so kind of strong, yes? And after some events in 2011, when some labor activists, they suffered, yes? Now also this question is very, very sensitive, yes? It's labor, what's going on, and right now, officially, legally, labor code is supportive for the employers, yes, not employees. As I said, the amount of rent which is available is not enough for different regional elite groups, yes, and UK elite groupings, they are more or less suffering from pressure of the bigger ones, yes, because the amount of rent has to be more or less renegotiated. Marginal opposition figures also, right now, opposition, I think, after elections of 2005, they were silenced and they are working more like in academic area. Right now, maybe they left. But some of the so marginal figures, they are also pressurized, yes, and it is more or less it is done not on the harsh way, it is more on the legal type of court decisions. So you see certain signals for foreign investors. One of the important signals that Kazakhstan is calling for the investors in processing industries to come, yes? And now the hopes are for Chinese presence because China is like industrializing developing country, can bring certain technologies to Kazakhstan as well. Yes? International Consortium and Eurasian Customs Union, it's, as also it was said by Dr. Aben, we have certain discussions about this customs union, especially with this accession to WTO, how these different tariffs can be pacified, renegotiated, recalculated. And still, as I understand, there is no common understanding what will happen. So that's our oil transportation routes. I think you are familiar with it. You see, in case of when Kazakhstan was in Soviet Union, it was this pipeline, and this pipeline, yes? All of them, they were going on like to Russian processing plants, and one was like in Shymkent, one was in Atarau, and one was in Babadar, but all of them, they were kind of connected with United Soviet type pipeline. The first private pipeline was built from Tengiz, which is giving around like 50% of overall Kazakh oil to Novorossiysk, yes, and it was, and it is the only private pipeline, I think, in Russia, in territory of Russia. Second, one of the most important, it is Baku-Tbilisi-Ceyhan, and it was considered that it would be Aktau-Baku-Tbilisi-Ceyhan. But Russian Federation and Iran, they object to build this pipeline because of environmental consideration and the absence of the legal status of the Caspian. The problem is that these sea pipelines, they exist, like Russia built this North Stream, South Stream, Norwegians, they have pipelines from North Sea to Europe. Yes, so you see this problem from technological, environmental, legal one, still it is not solved yet. And the last pipeline which is built, this Bazoy-Bineo-Shymkent, this is Chinese, oh, excuse me, it's a gas pipeline, but this one was built even like before Atasol-Shenko, yes, from the western Kazakhstan to western China, yes, to Kazakhstan. So you see all this like diversification, multi-vector policy in politics also is coming in reality in economics as well. So our national oil company, this parastatal institution, yes, it's very, very important for our economy. In terms of that it's representing Kazakh interest in large oil international projects, yes, like Kashagan, Tengiz, and Karachagana, important taxpayer of the state budget, and it's also very important as a regional employer. As we understand that oil business doesn't employ too much of the people, and national oil company is overstaffed. And it is working like as more or less fulfilling social role of employment. Yes, these workers, as I said, that right now, after these events in 2011, when some of the strikes were violently suppressed, there is a question that the workers' rights should be more or less resolved on the early stage, yes? But as I said, it's also contradictory things that new labor code is much more in the interest of employer. Yes, debt of Kazmunaygaz right now is $18 billion. And the question what is going on with the debt, with the profits, and the profits of Kazmunaygaz and the payments to the state budget of the taxes, they have fallen like on several levels. So now about Astana Expo. Kazakhstan is, when oil prices were high, had a commitment to build this to have Expo 2017, yes, and it was only one of the events in the line of the large events, and if we see that Kazakhstan was competing for Winter Olympic Games, yes, to be the capital of Winter Olympic Games, yes, OSCE Championship, and the question is why, what is going on, and all this idea of obsession to be like on the international scale. It's first of all for the new country, it's necessary, yes, to build certain public image. But one of the internal political considerations, and Astana Expo right now is also a hot topic, because if oil prices are low, social obligations of the country is going under the question, what is going on with why Astana Expo will kind of continue, yes? The question is legitimacy consideration. Why? Because in case of Kazakhstan, Our elections, as you know, last maybe 10 years, there are certain questions to these elections. And first of all, these things about this external, big external projects, they provide certain international recognition, and they provide also support from inside as well, that if we conduct certain things on international level, it means that country is more or less managing its oil income well. Yes. So you can find this news and events of Expo on this website. I put it over here also. You see it's all the time, there is a count how much time left for the start of the Expo. Yes, and right now in Astana, the construction works for Expo, they are going on 24 hours. Yes, 24 hours and one of the also this budget considerations, Expo exhibitions, they cut costs, I think, also on a certain level, I would say, and they also started optimization of their labor. So they recently it was a change of the management, I think it was in summer. Right now, Astana Expo, the idea is that everything will be fine in 2017. Yes, we have High Commissioner for Expo, and Kazakhstan is inviting all the participants, international participants, and we have several commitments to participate, yes, from other countries. So now other things for, like, when oil prices were high enough, Kazakhstan was thinking about this reindustrialization efforts, yes, and diversification of economy, issues of how to raise the national bourgeoisie, business and middle class, all the things they were on the agenda right now, situation shows that they were not solved on the proper level, yes? Because Kazakhstan launched several ambitious programs on this diversification, and so far, share of processing industries in GDP and in exports, it doesn't change, yes? There is debate what is going on with, because several billion dollars were spent on the diversification of economy, and idea is that this project, they cannot pay back so fast, yes, the effect on the economy will be felt after, I don't know, 5 years. Yes, so we will see it so far, employment, taxation, and like share in export of non-oil industries, non-raw material industries is, it doesn't change, I would say, yes. But Kazakhstan is progressing very well in doing business index, yes, and this in competitiveness index. All the time, we are more or less on the good positions, outperforming, you know, Ukraine, Russia, all other countries. On Transparency International and Freedom House ratings were doing not so well, but this doing business and competitiveness, they are more or less on good level, I would say. One of the ideas for this diversification and reindustrialization was to build the linkages around export sectors, yes, around grain sector, around oil sector, around like all these mining sectors, yes. And still, these ideas, formulations, programs, they are more or less, at least the concepts, they are in place, but it doesn't work so well. So the last slide, I want to show you this issue of green energy in Kazakhstan, because the topic of our expo is this green energy. Yes, it's very important for Kazakhstan in terms of our energy dimension for unit of produced GDP is very high. Yes, it's, I think it's higher than in Europe, three times, in United States it's higher than, our energy dimension is around twice of US. So you see, it means that energy is used not efficiently. Yes, need for energy efficiency in Kazakhstan, it is declared, it is discussed, and this green energy expo can be an impulse for changing the situation. Yes, so consumption and production of oil, we are producing around 80 million tons per year. Yes, and we consume only 20 million tons. Yes, and despite of this fact, Kazakhstan feels shortages for gasoline, And for this petrochemical industry is one of the main directions for this diversification process. Alternative energy potential for Kazakhstan in this regard is very, very promising, I would say. It's windy, there is solar, as you know that Kazakhstan has a lot of days in summer, summer is very hot and solar energy is available. Biogas, as it's like agriculture is still, Kazakhstan is more or less around 40% of population living in rural areas, and agriculture has a lot of potential. Biogas is discussed since 90s, that it can produce locally all this energy opportunity for the remote areas. Yes. So innovations for Kazakhstan in terms of productivity growth, they are first of all institutional one, yes, and right now one of the main hopes that the low prices they will instigate certain institutional changes as well, yes, in terms of property rights protection, independence of judiciary, and overall efficiency of the government service. So thank you very much.